Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Ashok Mittal. I head one NBFC company called PrestLoans, which is into small business and MSME lending in Delhi. This is my, in fact, second event from elets where I have been participating. Thank you for that. The subject of this panel discussion is how tech-driven NBFCs reinventing the security landscape. In a way, very unique and different subject, because when you say tech-enabled NBFC companies, and then you also say reinventing the security landscape, that effectively means lot many things to be discussed. And I'm really glad we have got a very experienced and varied panel with us to discuss various topics, issues, thoughts which they have on this subject. And maybe at the end, we will also have some interaction with the audience in terms of question answer and try to make it a little more interactive. I have Mr. Ganapathy from FundsCorner. We have Mr. Dominic from Art Affordable Housing, and we have Mr. Chakradhar from Vaya Microfinance. So you can see different sectors, affordable housing, MSME lending, microfinance, and I'm sure each one of them have been using technology in a big way from their perspective. While from each one of them, the audience or target audience is very different, the client segment is different, their understanding about their client's profile and usage of technology from those customers is very different. A microfinance customer may have a very different understanding of technology and security aspects, whereas an affordable housing customer will have a very different understanding. There are a lot of discussions have been happening around the globe, in India, in BFSI sector, in with reference to security of data, various tech audits or tech platforms, expectation from Reserve Bank of India in terms of how the NBFC companies should have their tech platforms, how they should ensure that there is a data security. In the previous session, in the inaugural session, there was a discussion how you should be using blockchain, big data analysis, etc. But my view is, at the same time, there is a lot of concern by the regulator, concern by the users, customers, let us say, ki whether the data which they are sharing is safe or not safe. Also, within the institution, or let us say NBFC, how they are, let's say, continuously upgrading or thinking about their technology. So these are the few things we will discuss. We have around, say, 45 minutes time. First of all, I would request the panels to give a little brief about themselves, about their organization, what is their role in the company, and then we will have a certain question and take their views. So I would request Mr. Dominic to start with.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Dominic. I am head of IT for Art Affordable Housing Finance. It's a five-year-old company based out of Gurgaon. We target the tier 3 and tier 4 segment customers. We have around 31 branches presently operating on the northern India and the western part of India. We have a pretty good big book size. Since it's a 4.5 year old company, we have a pretty good big size. And our company is totally technology driven. We can say that, you know, it's up to 80 to 90%. We drive the affordable housing segment works on my technology driven. We have where even my FOS starts using the tabs to acquire the customers. This is a small brief about our organization. Once the panel starts, we'll discuss on this.
Ganapathy.
Thanks, Dominic. My name is Ganapathy, and I am the CEO and co-founder of FundsCorner. We at FundsCorner provide small business loans to businesses who sell or buy online. Basically, we look at the digital footprint of the businesses and use it as alternate data points to assess their credit worthiness, and then use it to provide business loans, small business loans. We are highly tech enabled. We are pretty lean in terms of size, but we use technology to a large extent in our operations, both for risk assessment and to service customers, actually. Thanks.
Hello everybody, my name is Chakradhar. I'm head of IT for Vaya Finserv. I'm happy to update in this forum that Vaya is a 100% paperless company, and we have followed all the best practices within the information security domain is concerned. Thank you.
Thank you so much. So I'll start this question from Mr. Chakradhar. The main topic of the panel discussion, what according to you, your company has been doing with reference to reinventing the security landscape? What are the, let's say, challenges you found? How you have maybe some of the existing systems, processes you would have reinvented, you would have experienced when you actually interacted with the clients, and maybe including the some of the regulations which were there, and you might have to change certain processes or platform which you have. So how it has been your experience in terms of reinventing the security landscape in your company?
Sure, Ashok. In fact, as part of the IT applications rollout within the organization, we ensured the authentication and authorization is being proper, and there is even two-factor authentication and multi-factor authentication for the IT systems that we have. And at the same time, we have implemented, it's not just about IT applications, but from infrastructure standpoint also, you know, our data is being backed out and all our environments are on cloud. We don't own any, you know, in-premise physical servers at our office.
Yeah, Ganapathy, same question.
In our company, I mean, security as such comes from the way one looks at technology, embraces technology, actually. I mean, for all the NBFCs, even in the audience, it depends on how you look at technology or embrace technology. So once you embrace technology or bring technology as your core part of your business as such, that's going to drive your business, then looking at tech security also, data security also takes a front seat in everything that you look at. So that's what we have gone about in terms of we have built our proprietary technology as such, keeping that in mind, and everything that is done in our organization, both in the technology aspect as well as we have gone about building our systems, a proprietary lending platform, highly secure, and we create that awareness within the organization, for the employees as such, as well as for the customers, that security is paramount. I mean, that's how we have gone about.
Hey, Mr. Dominic, I think yours is a segment where it is more of affordable housing. So the requirement of funds by the customer is for a different purpose than the businesses, etc. At the same time, I'm sure you will have different challenges in terms of reinventing the whole thing, because affordable housing is subsector of housing finance in a way, right? So how it is different when you say housing loan or home loan, you say loan against property and then say affordable housing. And how is the tech different in your, let's say, organization versus these two different segments which we have, which are related to, let's say, collateral related to housing, but then what is different in affordable housing?
Okay, so coming back to your question, there is not much of difference between the housing loan and the affordable segment. It's only the ticket size which varies. The technology use remains the same, the data security remains the same, and only the way you acquire the customer remains the same. Yeah, must be an affordable segment. We go to the tier 3 and tier 4 cities. The kind of customers what we have are tea shop owners, grocery shop, cab drivers, these kind of customers we have. But end of the day, whatever we do, whether it's on housing, big ticket size or smallest ticket size, the question remains the same. The technology is the same thing what we use. We use app-based technology. We use the core lending system. And the data what we collect remains the same for everyone. So not much of difference between the homing loan or an affordable segment.
Okay, great. So I think what I have observed in last maybe couple of years is that whenever we say technology, whenever we say use of technology, in my personal view, it has been so far quite limited to the extent of KYC or eKYC, we call it. Let us say, if we have to get really authentication of the client, you will use Aadhaar database, and using that Aadhaar database, you are able to get to know about the clients. Beyond that, there has been limited use of technology with reference to integration with, let us say, credit information bureaus, where you can get the score and to some extent maybe analyze that score. But beyond that, from, in my view, from organization's perspective or the lender's perspective, the use of technology has been more into improving their own efficiencies. As far as customer experience is concerned, I think that's quite limited. Okay, he will come, he will give his Aadhaar authentication, and then he will apply for loan, and then he will start getting maybe email or text message, etc. The use of mobile application is quite limited as far as user is concerned, because the person who is a borrower, once he gets the fund, after that his utility of the application remains quite limited, whereas the utility for the lender is little comparatively quite high. So I have actually felt that the mobile application which we build for, let's say, borrower has to have some more features in terms of understanding that customer feels that it is useful for me. How your experience in terms of mobile applications have been, and whether you have actually created something new with reference to user experience on the mobile applications, where the user should feel that, okay, this is quite useful for him and not just a application for applying the loan. So any views or thoughts on that? Maybe we can start from here again.
As far as the field operations, you have nicely briefed about how exactly the customer can be onboarded and then how exactly that loan can be managed after that. Also, there are, you know, there are field operations wherein you know, they cannot carry any kind of laptops, or even there may not be a network in the rural areas especially. So for that, the system needs a lot of intelligence to work both in online as well as offline mode, and then do a data capture, and accordingly the data needs to be available to the decision makers. So you know, there are a lot of you know, the technological aspects as far as the loan management is concerned, which is rightly handled within our IT applications as well. One among them is the early notification via, you know, SMS messages to the user.
On that subject, typically financial institutions look at technology, I mean, the two aspects. One is to customer facing technology, that is channels primarily, and then the other one to process the process data, basically operational systems as such, and then goes on to analytics side. Now, in my opinion, at least for customer facing technology, we have financial institutions so far, the large financial institutions have not looked at that as an engaging channel as such. I mean, I was giving an example that a short while earlier, that mobile app in, that is given by a leading bank in Singapore, you can, there's a feature there that if you want to visit a branch, for example, you can use the app to look at how long the queue is in the branch, in the teller counter. Right? I mean, that's a kind of engaging. I mean, that's why the customer will come to your app, actually, will use it. So to that extent, we should go. We should go engage. And similarly, even in a lending institution, we typically, banks and larger financial institutions don't look at customer as part of the journey as such. You apply for a loan, and then you sit and wait and pray for the loan to be approved or some status to be. So we at FundsCorner, we are striving to bring customer as part of the journey, whereby, in my opinion, that's what institutions should look at, basically bring customers as part of the loan application journey as such. I mean, the various stages it goes through, so there is complete transparency in the whole thing as such. I mean, that's how, in my opinion, financial institutions should look at technology, because technology, as I said earlier, there should be a cultural shift in the way financial institutions look at technology, actually. I mean, I can give you an example. A few years ago, when I was working for a large banking software provider earlier, in a branch, overseas branch of a public sector bank in India, as soon as we sent an email, we used to go to the chief manager of the branch and say, sir, we have sent you an email. OK, Okay, the computer will be this far off from him. He'll just move his chair there. Oh, acha, you'll open the laptop, see the email, take a printout of it, and then read it. Take a printout of it and read it, actually. Right? I mean, we have come a long way, I suppose, but technology is something that should not be imposed upon you by somebody. I mean, the moment technology is imposed upon an institution, the way they use it will be, there will not be any business benefit that can be accrued. It can automate a set of things, but the business value that it would accrue to the institution will be very, very minimal, in my opinion. So the way the business look at technology as a business driver, as such, that's fundamental in the way technology can be used to drive growth in the business as such.
Okay. Mr. Dominic.
In affordable segment, basically we use the mobile app, which is purely on customer acquisition. It's right from the, we go to the doorstep of the customer, we acquire the customer. It's up to the level where the login happens. So it's a real-time activity. This is one place we use the app. The second place, we use the app when the customer starts tracking his application. These are two places. And in the affordable segment, you can't force a customer to go get an app installed and, you know, just like a premium sector customer where he starts tracking it. It's only for a time period he'll be using the app till the loan gets approved. And after, I think, customer stays with us for 10 to 15 years. During the tenure, you can inform him on the pre-EMI or in case there's any kind of check bounce and all those things through the app we can do. These are only two kind of situations where we really bring in the mobile app, we really bring in the technology and sit using it.
Okay. The another point in my mind, and I would want maybe audience to think about it. How many of you really read the terms of use, terms and conditions before really accepting and going forward for any kind of app installation or a website? Can you raise your hands? Anybody who would have read everything and then said yes, no? Okay, how many people have not read it and said yes? Okay. So my next question is on this. Not related to any individual entity or your own organization or any organization, is there are a lot of guidelines with RBI guidelines, let us say, when we do any agreement with a third party in terms of security of data, how the user data should be secured and how it should not be shared with somebody else, as well as the kind of terms and conditions put by various organizations, institutions, terms and conditions, terms of use, privacy policy, cookies policy, caches. So there are so many things which I'm sure as a user, even all of us also don't really read. But how useful they are for user, for organization, for regulator, or for somebody else? Because this is an area which I think is quite open area in terms of data security, as far as security of data or the security landscape which you're talking is. We have recently seen lot action happening after Analytica thing. And we have got mails from almost every organization that we have changed or updated our security policy or cookies policy, etc. And again, we all of us have just accepted it and kind of moved it. How useful it is, in your view, from regulator's perspective or from user perspective or for organization's perspective? I mean, other than the legal requirement, do you think it is useful, or how we can actually make it more useful for people? How can we make it smaller, shorter, crisp, make it, let's say, more visible, transparent to the people so that they know, okay, these are the three things I am actually allowing, let us say. Because when you install an application or app, then you know, okay, I'm allowing them camera, recording, contacts, SMS, email, etc., etc. So how, I know this is maybe little conflicting, difficult point, but my view is that most of the users are quite concerned about it. So what is your view, how it should be done, how it should be tackled, or whether there was also a need to, let us say, reinvent the whole thing? The point is reinventing and the security landscape. Reinvent the whole thing so that everybody, the user and the organization, is secure. And I would like to start this from Dominic, because I heard him in Mumbai and he was quite good at that.
To be very frank, as per the terms and conditions, the policies, or this, whatever the new things which is coming up, many of the customers don't have so much of patience to read it. The issue comes up whenever there's a litigation which crops up. During that time is the time where we have a litigation issue with the customer, then we talk about you have read the terms and conditions, have you taken it up, and you agree to it. Post that only we are given this. So to cut down on this, cut down on the terms and conditions or whatever the GDPR policies which has come out newly, I don't see that, you know, this can be cut down or it can be reduced. It, basically, the mentality of any, even for me, I just blindly say okay for it. Okay, I don't really sit and read that page of terms and conditions, what is there. But when the issue comes up, then we think about all those things. But this is always a debatable question, which I may not be able to comment further till we really get into those things.
Ganapathy, you have anything in thoughts on this?
Terms and conditions, I mean, as you said, in the app, it's pretty simple. I mean, it's laid out in a simple language. If you want to read through a three-pager, sometimes it's drafted in a way that you do not understand what it is, actually. As long as everybody who is using it would understand that certain level, data is shared with partners as such. It should be more explicit in the way, I mean, being honest with the customer, and the customer will always stay with you. And if you try to circumvent it by putting it in a legal jargon which nobody understands, it's a challenge, but that's how the industry is operating right now. I mean, unless you come up with something completely different, it's going to stay the same, actually.
Mr. Chakradhar.
Though the master directions from RBI has come in last year, considering the portfolio buckets, you know, it should be the doctrine of that particular organization to have their own information security management system, which would govern, you know, all the information security processes and policies. And that should not be like a legal requirement, but that should be a day-to-day practice wherein every associate needs to comply with the process and policies framed by the organization. And RBI also mandates to have this ISMS system to be approved by the board of the organization. So it's always good to have the business contingency environment and then to invoke in terms of whenever there is a contingency. You know, it describes a lot many things within their guidelines, and it's a serious matter to be imbibed.
Okay, I think another aspect of this whole thing is, and in the previous session there was one specific term used, that we should use technology to improve our efficiencies, to improve the environment, to improve the user experience, to improve system and processes, etc. But we should not be a slave of technology. There were examples quoted by the previous speakers in terms of what kind of, let us say, bad experience or situations they had which were not really so pleasant for them. Also, I think lot many people have been talking on this, that is it like tech and tech, only tech, or it is tech and touch? How relevant the tech and touch philosophy is? Like, should we do the entire process which is let's say tech enabled, not really having any touch thing means the direct interaction with the client, visiting the client, meeting the client, or let's say going to the client or client coming to you, etc. I mean, or it's entirely digital thing. So how, in your experience, each one of you have this feeling that one, this question in two aspects. One is from organization's perspective. What is your view that, okay, I think there's no touch required, no meeting required, and you can totally know what they call it, like whether it can be tech, fizzy tech kind of a thing, and and everything should be digitally done, and there is no need to really go and meet or talk or interact with the client. And what is your experience in terms of client's perspective? How much the client feels that he should really go meet, talk, should see the organization, feel the organization, etc. So from both ways, if you have any perspective, I'll start from Mr. Chakradhar this time.
In fact, it's always good and better to know your customer more and more and be in touch with the customer with respect to periodic meetings with them and get to know, you know, what exactly are their problems. This would really help in terms of, you know, getting the required collections from them and to clock the attendance accordingly and to understand the reasons why exactly the customer is not turning up to the center meeting for any given collection meetings. So it's always good to be in touch with the customer apart from, you know, IT system helping the loan officer to make better decisions out of it.
Yeah, I mean, the extent of tech and touch, in my opinion, varies depending on the segment you're targeting, actually. I mean, some customer segment or demographic, for example, they don't want to speak to anybody. They want to get things done, tech, basically, millennials, for example. There, tech, I mean, you can, in fact, you can go ahead and introduce bots also. Bots to give service specific to the service he's looking at, actually. So there, a lot of tech and less of touch would be needed. Whereas if you're looking at a segment or a demography where, I mean, who are more comfortable with touch, there the limit of tech, the extent to which the tech is involved. So the financial institutions should go to the way, to the extent that I use technology to provide service in a way that the customer is acceptable. I mean, if somebody, for example, in a branch, if a customer walks in, the teller looking at the monitor should know that today is his waiting day or birthday. Yes. I mean, they should wish, yes, basically. To that extent, the technology should go. I mean, that's where the human touch is. Otherwise, the technology, the monitor that he or she is looking at is of absolutely no use, actually. I mean, if cannot establish that touch. But the extent to which tech is used depends on the audience again. Like I was reading the other day that millennials are moving away, 40% of the millennials are moving away from mobile banking because it's not fast enough for them. I mean, we are now, only recently people have started a lot of mobile banking experience as such. Many banks are still catching up, but it's not a problem in India alone. It's across the globe. The problem exists across the globe where we are only catching up with, we are using technology more to automate things. Financial institutions have used technology to automate things, more on the operational side, not on the customer. We don't realize that the technology that I am forcing it upon the customer is, we don't even realize whether it's good or bad the customer experience is. I think the extent to which we use tech should be dependent on what the customer preferences are. I think that's where we should go.
To answer your query, the segment where I work, come from, okay, though we use technology for accuracy, control fraud, to reduce the TAT, and you know, we see that thing. But end of the day, that human touch is required by the customer because that size of ticket size of customer who we work with around 20 lakhs, 30 lakhs maximum. So they always prefer to be, they want to have some physical structure of the branch. They want to come down to the branch. Okay, they want to meet people, talk to them. Then only there's a confidence level which is built in. So in our segment, we need to have both technology as well as human touch. Yeah, technology, we may, from the organization point, we can streamline the process, cut down on the TAT, then, you know, fraud, then you, security and all that can be thing. But end of the day, when you look at customer, who generates business for me has to have a human touch, and he prefers to have a human touch. Though we do a EKYC, we still go to his house and get it done. And when you're signing a loan document, when he comes to my office, when he does an e-sign, he has to come to my document. He can't sit at home, or I can't do it digitally. So that human touch has always to be built between the customer.
Sure. In fact, in our organization at PrestLoans also, we have been using in the similar way. Your onboarding of the client, the processing of loan application and the sanction, everything happens online. But at the same time, we have kind of devised a mechanism where at least two people are going to meet the client at different times. So he knows that there are two levels where he can connect with people in case of one person is not available. And at the same time, one very different experience I had that is related to small business units, in fact. When we ask those clients to come to office for whatever purpose, they generally have been coming because they are very small, very, very small, maybe tea seller, maybe fruits and vegetables seller, maybe a some grocery store, etc., who are proprietorship firms. So they will typically come with family. So normally they will come with a wife or kid also. And we have kept a small, gift hamper type something which we give to their kids when they come with some chocolate or something to drink, etc. And that has actually helped us in terms of connecting emotionally with the guy. So I hope that somewhere it has built that relationship with the people, that your default ratio comes down, because once they have seen you personally, your family, your kid, somebody has visited the office, and then they are able to connect with you directly in terms of, okay, this is the bank or NBFC or institution which we have visited. So I think net-net, there are a lot many things which are happening around in this financial ecosystem where the technology is being used not only just to improve efficiency, but also to scale up the operations where you can go to the places or you can do the things which are very difficult to do manually. Fortunately, we have got three different segments here with us. We have affordable housing, we have microfinance, we have small business MSME segment, even we do small business MSME segment. So we have some time, maybe around 5 minutes or so, if there are audience who want to ask any questions, generally with reference to the subject, how the tech-driven NBFC companies has been reinventing the security landscape. So if you have anything to know or you want to share, you want to ask something from the speakers with reference to this particular point in terms of data security, etc., or if you have any specific point to know with reference to affordable housing, MSME lending or small business lending or microfinance institutions, you can have your questions. We can take maybe two or three questions. Can you give mic this? I would request you please introduce yourself briefly and then ask the questions. You can name the person whom you want to question. You can address the person.
My name is Vimal Kumar Jain. I am legal advisor of Veena Jain Mortgages, and we do mortgages business. And this is regarding Precision Biometric. Biometric, they have told a lot of things about biometric, that we can, by thumb impression, we can take their data and find out other this thing. Is that anything that new which can come by their biometric, we can know that fellow is going to pay or going to abscond? If such a things come out, then there won't be any NPS or anything bad in the finance industry. My question is regarding any biometric fingerprint that which will bring development, no minus.
Understood.
I think technically that may not be possible. Okay. Must be we may use some kind of data captured and can do some kind of analytics to predict if the customer is going to pay me or not. I think biometric wise, I don't think we can do that.
In fact, quite interesting point. And I guess the time is not really far when you will be able to get a lot of information. So blockchain is actually all about that. Biometrics effectively means we will be able to know the identity of the person. Gradually, more and more information about you, me, and all of us is getting on the internet space. So whether you use it or not, the moment you are using, let us say, Chrome, you use Google, you use Facebook, you use lot many social media, you post lot many things on the website, you post your pictures, etc. So somewhere people are actually going towards this environment where your social profile reflects something about you. So once you are able to, let's say, establish the identity that this is this person, so it may not be there today, but I think it will definitely happen sooner than what we think. That based on the identity, people will be able to draw. Currently also people are able to draw some information, draw information, and to know what kind of behavior, social behavior, financial behavior, this person might have. So you may not exactly know this person will default or not, but you will be able to draw some clues. And even today, some fintech companies try to do that from social media, I will be able to analyze and put that behavior in the score metrics, right? So I think day is not far, you will be able to get a lot more information by biometrics that what kind of behavior this person does. Anybody else? Okay, so I think we are up with the time as well. I would like to thank all the panelists for their wonderful experience sharing. If I really want to summarize it, everybody in the different field, but I think broadly the mechanism in terms of using technology has been more or less same. All kind of organizations, whether they are into affordable housing, microfinance, MSME lending, etc., they are using technology to improve efficiencies, I guess. There have been lot many, I will say, demands, expectations, challenges in terms of securing the data, and everybody has to continuously reinvent the whole security landscape, because it is not only about the client data, but also the entire information, the internal security system of the data, how people use the information, whether the information should go out or not. And despite of using entire technology, I guess still there is some scope, at least in our country, where people still want that physi-tech thing to happen, physical plus technology, or let's say physical or touch and tech, whatever you call it. There is a lot more scope, I think. Thank you very much, gentlemen. Thanks a lot. Thanks for audience.